Good evening. Welcome to the College of Education and Lehigh University. I'm Gary Sasso, and I'm the Dean of the College of Education, and this is our Lehigh Symposium within the college. This is now our eighth event that we have hosted, and as a College of Education, we are in the business of trying to help to change the lives of children through our research, through our graduate colleges, through our six distinct programs, work with individuals, schools, and organizations, our work nationally, internationally, and at the policy level. With this lecture symposium, what we've been trying to do is to bring together some of the leading professionals in their respective areas, including our own faculty, to address the most pressing issues we face in the education of children. In the past, we've highlighted a number of different areas. 3 years ago, we highlighted autism spectrum disorders. 2 years ago, the issues facing children within our urban schools, and last year, children with severe emotional, behavioral, and mental illness issues. Tonight, we have a number of leading experts whose work in the area of learning disabilities is really changing the way we look at these students and the way we address all of their needs. But first, before we start, I want to introduce to you our Lehigh University Provost, Dr. Patrick Farrow, to provide his welcome to you. Pat is in his third year as our Provost and Vice President for Academic Affairs. For those of you who don't know what a Provost actually does at a university, he's the person who runs the place. Before coming to Lehigh, Dr. Farrell served as the Provost and Vice Chancellor for Academic Affairs at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. He is a professor of mechanical engineering with more than 25 years' experience as a teacher, as a researcher, and as a leader. Pat is Lehigh's Chief Academic Officer and is leading our effort to attract and recruit and retain highly talented individuals to Lehigh, as well as playing a central role in ensuring the success of our institutional goals over the next decade. I hope you have a good evening tonight.
Thanks, Gary. Let me add my welcome to all of you to Lehigh. Some of you have been here before. For some of you, this may be your first time. Either way, we're delighted you're here. Lehigh is proud of many things, but one of the things we're most proud of is our people, our faculty, our staff, our students. Like any great university, these are the people who make the place, who remake it every day, every week, every year. In particular, what these people do and how they do it and what impact that has, not just on the university but on the world around them, is again what makes great universities great. You may have heard a phrase that we use a lot here at Lehigh, theory to practice. What you're seeing tonight is an example of that very thing, is how is it that theories, ideas, new ways of thinking about challenges around education can be turned from ideas into practical applications that you can use. So I hope you walk away from this evening's event with some idea of some new theories you may not have heard before or haven't heard in a while, but most importantly, some ways that you can put those to work to affect the children you work with every day. Again, we're delighted you're here and really hope you find this to be a fulfilling and rewarding evening. Now I want to introduce your moderator for the evening, Professor Ed Shapiro. Professor Shapiro is currently Professor of School Psychology and Director of the Center for Promoting Research to Practice in the College of Education. He's a 2006 winner of the Senior Scientist Award given by the Division of School Psychology, the American Psychological Association. In recognition of a senior member of the field who has provided a sustained program of outstanding theory and research to the field of school psychology. Over the past 10 years, Dr. Shapiro has been working as a consultant with the Pennsylvania Department of Education to facilitate an effort to establish progress monitoring systems for students in special education, and is currently collaborating with the Pennsylvania Department of Education in developing and facilitating the implementation of the response to intervention methodology for the state. Please welcome Dr. Shapiro.
Good great to see everyone this evening. What a wonderful, wonderful opportunity and a wonderful crowd to hear from some incredible people. And I have the wonderful opportunity to sort of be your moderator tonight, ask some questions that maybe people from the audience are thinking of, and have some good conversations as we go. Let me introduce tonight's panel. First of all, Dr. Dan Reschly. Dan, as you know from your program, is from Vanderbilt University, and Dan is someone I've known for a long time, always challenges traditional thinking. He's the guy we all go to when we want straight talk, so we'll probably hear that tonight. And Dan's going to be speaking on evidence-based instruction in Tier 1 and teacher preparation. The second presenter tonight is Dr. George Batsche from the University of South Florida. And George is somebody who always gets people excited about his ideas. An energetic individual, he makes things happen. He's going to speak tonight very much about the work of RTI in the state of Florida, where he's been involved in a statewide effort to scale up RTI. The third speaker tonight is Dr. Beth Calhoun, who's joined us here at Lehigh University. Beth's an individual who has a background as a teacher, particularly at middle school. She has a great focus on teaching reading to kids who really struggle, and has developed an empirically supported curriculum, which Beth will talk a little bit about tonight in her presentation. And finally, Dr. Naomi Zygmunt. Dr. Naomi Zygmunt from the University of Pittsburgh is well known as a strong advocate for the instruction of students with learning disabilities. She's not always been a great advocate for inclusionary practices, which I'm sure we're going to hear about tonight. And her focus will be very much on the talk of getting kids with learning disabilities what they really need for education. Let's have a round of applause for our panel. So I'm going to start us off tonight with a little bit of a simple question why, and I'm going to ask the audience to take 1 minute to do something. I want you to turn to the person next to you, if you're in education in particular, and ask yourself the simple question, why did you enter this field? Let's take 1 minute for everyone to do that, and you're allowed to have no more than 3 to 5 words in your answer. Very quickly. Shuttle discovery. And I want to make things better is another reason you might have heard. What didn't you hear? You didn't hear that I want to make money. That's why I got into the field. Or I could really get a nice retirement out of this. That wasn't what you heard. Or I really love the hours. Or there's plenty of job opportunities. That's why I went into this. I came across a very interesting documentary in HBO, and I'm going to play a short clip of this documentary that sort of, I think, articulates something about why we got into this field ourselves.
Nobody understood what I was going through. Nobody knew what was wrong with me.
We were told that she will never learn to read. They said she's just slow.
Can you read the second question?
What really happened in the second?
You start thinking, what did I do wrong? I can't help it.
I knew my son was hurting a lot, and we just didn't understand him.
I felt like I can't do anything. Then I thought, maybe I could just change the future.
After I went to this new school, everything just turned around for the better. Now I can express myself a lot more, and it feels good.
I used to really hate reading. Now I love books.
I'm like, okay, I'm not good at handwriting. I can still play guitar.
It is motivational.
I still have problems with math, but I can do trip hiking.
I'll think of something that I've overcome, and that'll help lift me.
It's really important for children to have extra help. That's what makes
and able to go on to great things.
Some things about learning disabilities I think that we all pretty much know. Specific learning disabilities are the single largest category of disabilities among all of those that we identify. It makes up something like 41.4% of the students who are actually identified as having special ed needs, and it's about 3.5% of the overall population. But what's interesting is there's been a decline in the presence of identified learning disabilities over the past year, and in particular, in the last 3 years, there's been a very substantial decline. And it's really unknown why this is actually the case. And just some data taken out of the U.S. Department, or the population of the United States, you can begin to see that in the last several years, from about the year 2000, we began a slight decline. And if you take a look at what these numbers actually mean, in the last 3 years, between 2008 and 2010, we've had a decline from 3.77% 3.51%, which is actually a drop of 110,000 students, so it's not a small number we're talking about, although it looks like that when you look at percentages. If you look across the last years, between 2004 and 2010, again, the percent of special ed in the population of students with special ed needs has also declined quite a bit. And what's happened very much in this period of time is there's this changing landscape in understanding and identifying what we mean by a student with learning disabilities. We always still see it as unexpected underachievement. We have students who we expect to be doing better. All the indicators are they should be fine, they should be successful in school, but they're not. And we identify the particular areas, of course, in which they're struggling. Things like oral expression, listening comprehension, written expression, or basic reading skills. But historically, the method by which we've made this identification, the method of discrepancy, which is when we look at the comparison between essentially the student's IQ score and their achievement scores, have really been problematic. It's been problematic since it's been used, and it's a problem that was identified over a long period of time in the research. And the major change, as we all know, that change in the law was a permission to do this a little differently, to take a different approach to identifying kids, and that approach, of course, is known as response to intervention. Here in Pennsylvania, we called it response to instruction and intervention to emphasize the importance of instruction for all students as the key to making this whole process work. Well, RTI very quickly changed. It began and was put in place initially as an idea to help identify students with learning disabilities, but very quickly it was identified and found that this is a way to provide better instruction to all students, to make stronger instruction for all students, and to really enhance the process of instruction. The opportunity to change the trajectory of the learning curve for students who are identified at a very young age and potentially at risk of not succeeding became possible, and this began to change the way in which we essentially identify and start with and use the process of response to intervention. One of the things we quickly understood was that if we were going to use this to identify kids with learning disabilities, we had to be doing what's now known as a multi-tier system of supports, MTSS. We had to do something that would enable us to identify kids at a very young age, put in place strong interventions that can change their trajectory and result in less risk down the pike, and therefore potentially fewer students who are in need of the level of special education that is so deserved of kids who really need that level. What's really, of course, interesting is we can be doing this. We can be doing a multi-tier system of supports, providing support for education for all kids, providing the safety net that's needed, and we don't have to be doing necessarily identifying kids using this methodology, although it's permitted. And in truth, in our state and around the country, this is more of what's happening. Most schools are implementing RTI in the country are implementing it predominantly as a system of change, not necessarily to identify kids with learning disabilities. However, you're going to hear from at least one presenter in a state where this has been done systematically in the state and really implements across the entire state in a way that impacts the whole process of identification. So what is RTI? It's this multi-tier system of supports. It's a systematic way of providing and organizing the educational process. What it takes advantage of is it takes advantage of what we know to be the strengths of our teachers, the strengths of our interventions, and the ability to provide data-driven decisions for student outcomes. The key to RTI is the data. The data that drives our decision about what instruction works and when instruction is not working, well, how we can change that instructional process. In Pennsylvania, this is the model that we so dearly hold. It's a triangle. If you talk about RTI, you know, you're going to see triangles. This is the Pennsylvania model, which has been used and put in place since about 2007 and is really now taken off in our state. I have a brief video that I'm going to show, just a very brief video. Gives a perspective from the field about what RTI can do and what it's about.
Everybody wants to do what's best for kids. That's why we got in business. With the checks and balances of RTI and the systems that you put in place, that's what happens.
In my practice and my work with folks around the country, it really is looking at a systemic approach to making sure that all kids get what they need, which includes kids with disabilities all the way up to our highly gifted kids. They have not been pushed to higher levels. So response intervention is an initiative and an innovation that when used with really good leadership can really reach all of our kids in our schools.
I thought to myself, here's my principals, two principals sitting there talking about a child's R control vowels, which I always thought were important as a teacher of children with learning disabilities, but I really had never heard a whole group of people talking about how to best work on those skills with a child. So it was really efficient for us as teachers because we could have conversations amongst each other as to, you know, where do you think the child is breaking down? What services does the child need? It was really fun to be a part of that team and realize that these children are probably not going to be labeled as a child with a learning disability. This child is going to have the intervention they need right here from the regular in class. It was very exciting.
You're seeing that the state score is going up. You know, and when we're looking at benchmark data, from you know, first, second, third benchmark, oh my lord, they're flying, they're skyrocketing. That's great, because those are all the sub-skills they need to be able to read later on. We've gotten smarter on how to teach kids, studying data, studying kids, and then moving forward and helping them out.
We have to fix that sentence and make it a good sentence. Isn't that exciting?
There's going to be kids that are struggling readers, but they're not special ed. We're giving them support, and we're hopefully going to get them more independent on using these support systems so when they get into the higher grades, they'll be able to use those support systems in order to achieve at the level that they need.
This isn't a continuum of support for just struggling students, but for all students. And some of the data that I have seen that other principals have shared with me shows increased enrollment in honors classes, AP classes, reduction of discipline issues, which keeps the focus more on instruction. And these are all the elements that are so critical. And that data needs to continually be shared with principals, with the staffs and buildings, so that they understand this is about improving instruction for all kids.
Why do RTI? Because it works. It truly does. It captures those kids that otherwise may have been going into special ed. That don't need to be there.
These are beautiful. And she's been working very hard, but she's very proud. So she had to come by Mr. Kahn, Mr. Crawford, so we can get that in school.
I think that again captures the feelings of a lot of educators, a lot of administrators around the country about RTI. Very quickly, I want to just briefly point, anytime I present, I have to present data or I don't survive the presentation. Over the last 4 years, we completed a project called Project MP3. It was a project in which Dr. Naomi Zygmunt and I were co-directors. Naomi dealt with the group in Pittsburgh area. We dealt with the group here, actually in the Harrisburg area. And we took a look recently, using the results of the PSSA as our criterion at third grade, to students who were identified during their kindergarten year, the middle of kindergarten, who were identified as in need of something more than the core level tier one support. And we tracked those kids to the end of third grade and looked at what percentage of those kids ended up proficient on the PSSA, in this case in reading. And I think there's good news and there's bad news. The good news was that in at least one of our schools, we could move and get almost 80% of those kids who are identified in kindergarten to be successful by the end of third grade. One school, we could only get 43% of our kids that way. So on the good news side, we have as many as 78% of our kids that we could correct, and on the bad news, we couldn't do this for more than 43% of one group, but we have 60% of our kids we couldn't be successful about. So that RTI is not the only thing that we need to do. It's not the panacea. It doesn't answer all the questions. But if I can move 60 to 70% of kids' trajectories that I can identify in kindergarten as being successful by the end of third grade and reading, I've accomplished something significant, and that makes RTI a very powerful potential tool in the arsenal of making really good and effective school change. So tonight you're going to hear four different perspectives on intervention, four different perspectives related to improving outcomes for kids with learning disabilities, each from a little different viewpoint. One from a state perspective, one related to teacher education, one related to what do you do with kids who are now in middle school and really can't read, and one related to what do you do with, how do we really serve our kids with learning disabilities. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce our first speaker, Dr. Dan Reschly, who will now allow us to get on with the show. Dan.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here tonight, and I'm impressed with so many people who came out. There's surely something to compete with this. And I appreciate your dedication. How many of you are teachers? That's wonderful. I have good news for you, and we'll get to that in just a moment. Let's go to let's see, we gotta get this to work. Hello? I'm doing a top button, pointing to the right. There we go, okay. I'll only show this briefly. Ed's already put up a pyramid. Some of you teachers are very tired of seeing the pyramid. The only point I want to make is that teachers are essential to the positive effects of response to intervention at all tiers, but especially at tier one. Good teachers at tier one who can achieve the goal of 80% of children on course toward passing benchmarks are essential to the success of the entire system. Now here's some more good news. It's a little less clear than it was this afternoon. I mean, the more good news. It's better now. Okay. The good news is the teacher effects are significant. Teachers make an enormous difference. Some of you may come from a few years ago, like I do, and you recall the Coleman Report. Recall the famous Coleman Report, I believe in 1976, or maybe, no, 1966, that essentially attributed differences among individuals and groups to family background factors. And the amount of variance accounted for by teachers seemed to be relatively little, and the fact was that the general policy implication was that one teacher is about as good as another, and teachers didn't make that much difference. That's changed. Beginning with large-scale studies in the 1980s, continues in the 90s, and through this decade, teachers matter a lot. We have something called the Tennessee Value Added Assessment that's done annually, and Bill Sanders and his colleagues can show that 3 years of a teacher who is in the top 20% of teacher effects overcomes the effect of socioeconomic status. That is, three good teachers in a row overcomes the effect of poverty. That's dramatic. That's a big difference. Now, those are teachers that are in the top 20% of teacher effects. Here's another couple of slides that I think illustrate just how important teacher effects can be. I guess I have to stay here. This is a slide based on an entire classroom in an elementary school in the western part of the United States. 100% of the students in this classroom are eligible for free and reduced cost school lunch. About 99% of the students in that school were African American. We have the first kindergarten classroom. It's I went ahead of this. It's a classroom that's very much emphasizing direct instruction. Go back, please. Go back two more. All right, here's where we start. These are the effects of the teacher's instruction from the fall to the winter. So in the fall, we have one student at 12 going down to one in terms of correct sounds per minute. By January, we have one, two students meeting the benchmark of 25, two others that are maybe approaching it, and the rest of the students, 14 students, not reaching the benchmark. Is that good enough? Well, traditionally, we would have rationalized, all these kids are poor, they're minority, they come from lousy language backgrounds, on and on and on and on, you're familiar with the litany. And we can rationalize this until we see the classroom next door. Teacher, using traditional direct instruction, the same population of kids, a larger class of these children, and dramatically better results. Teachers matter, especially in terms of early reading skills. Teachers matter a lot. Well, then we go from winter to spring. More complex task, phoneme segmentation per minute. These effects tend to be cumulative. Here's the first classroom, radically constructivist, literacy kind of instruction. And as you can see, we have a few students meeting benchmark, but most do not. Is that good enough? When we look at this classroom, we have a very different answer to that, don't we? And the difference between these two classrooms is instruction. Both teachers are kind, they interact well with kids. I was in both classrooms many times. It was instruction. Instruction makes that much difference. Now, the question for the rest of my presentation is, to what extent are current teacher preparation programs preparing teachers to provide this kind of instruction in reading and in other areas? First, meta-analysis results. Meta-analysis is a way to summarize the results of a large number of studies expressed in standard deviation units. So an effect size of zero means no effect. An effect size that's positive means that the group that received the particular program score better or turn out better outcomes than the group that did not receive that treatment or some other treatment. As we can see, there are some very substantial meta-analyses that we know about. One of them that Ed has been a leader on and is very important in Pennsylvania is the use of formative evaluation using curriculum-based measurement in various subject areas, plus graphing against goals, plus decision-making. Regarding changing instruction or raising the goal, plus reinforcement for effort and gains. Do that, you get a full standard deviation effect. There are several others here that have very substantial effect sizes, particularly direct and structured instruction. What's the effect size of matching instruction to learning styles? I haven't had to change that effect size in 40 years. Zero. Zero times zero is zero. Zero plus zero is zero. It's zero. No effect. Now, how many teachers in this country are being taught about matching instruction to learning styles versus the number of teachers that are being taught direct systematic instruction? I'll leave that out there for just a moment. That's another one of the effect size. Generally, the lower the prior knowledge you have, the more you need direct instruction. All of you experience this, don't you? Anybody out there have difficulty with modern technology, learning new software on a computer? My son loves to come home over the holiday break and install some kind of new electronic gadgetry for Chris Ann and me, and then he absconds back to Chicago. Then we can't get the TV on. So, he's very arrogant toward me and much nicer toward Chris Ann. So we argue about who's going to have to call him to find out how to turn it on. So I ended up wanting to watch a sports event, so I had to do the call. And so he explains to me, Dad, there are three remotes in the room. Can you find them? Now, can you find the one that has sort of a silver background and black buttons? Got that one? Now, notice that there are rows and columns. Go to the middle column, count down five rows, push the button, and the TV went on. I hung up. I didn't even thank you. Does that happen to any of you? What I need, when I need to learn new computer software, I need direct explicit instruction. I get Excel for dummies. What about kids who come to school with weaker language backgrounds, who have not had as much experience with the printed symbols and words? Do they need less or more direct and systematic instruction? I think the answer is obvious. That's another thing. Now, do we have children that struggle in reading? What I'm presenting next will be the 2011 fourth grade reading results. The National Assessment of Educational Progress presents those results in four categories. Below basic, which means less than partial mastery. Less than partial mastery. About a third of all kids in the United States score below basic in reading. At the end of, this is the middle of fourth grade. Middle of fourth grade. If you're below basic in reading in the middle of fourth grade, your chances of reading at a basic level or above by the end of high school are about 0.2. In other words, about 20% of the students. In other words, 80% of the students. And then we look at it across different groups in the country. We have a problem. If kids don't learn to read with a reasonable degree of competence by the end of third grade or so, their chances of doing well academically and having a lot of career choices are seriously compromised. That's another one I'll skip. Quickly. There we go. Now, we've known this for a long time. This isn't new information. Here's the 2000 book by one of my heroes, Jeannie Chong. Direct explicit instruction. Teach all elements of the task. Go through the instructional routine, model, teacher, student, do it simultaneously. Student does it with feedback. Student practices to automaticity. Integrate with other skills, continue on. That kind of instruction. Now, most teacher preparation programs not only do not emphasize that kind of instruction, and I'm saying most, not all, not only do not emphasize that kind of instruction, in fact, they teach students to avoid it. That sort of explicit, direct instruction. And the rest of this is about teacher prep and what we need for our TI. Studies of prominent colleges of education, top 20 rated colleges of education, looking at their teacher prep program, and you find that there's very little direct instruction, okay? Now I want to go to the National Reading Report. I'm keep punching around for that time, it didn't work good. National Reading Report, published in 1998, Snowbirds and Griffin, emphasized five content areas of reading that most teachers can now, at least elementary teachers, can say in the middle of the night, awakened in a deep sleep, right? But there were other elements emphasized in that report, including direct systematic instruction, universal screening, and formative evaluation. Question, how well are those incorporated in the colleges of education teacher preparation programs? There's a copy of the report. Oh, incidentally, this is new. Some of you will enjoy this slide. Do you see how much I paid for the book? I read this book. It's a 1967 book. I read it for the comprehensive examinations that I took in 1970. Spring of 1970. I paid $2.95 for the book. All right, here's a study. It's highly controversial, but it's way more wrong, way more right than wrong. It's done by Kate Welsh, Welsh, Glazer, and Wilcox. Published in 2006 by the National Council on Teacher Quality. What they looked at was a sample of 72 institutions of higher education. They looked very closely at these 72 institutions of higher education programs for preparing teachers to teach reading. They looked specifically at as how well do the programs teach the five basic content components of reading, phonemic awareness, phonic, you can all say that in your sleep. Out of 72, there were 11 who taught all five components reasonably well. There were 31 that went 0 for 5. 31, kind of what the Patriots receivers did in the second half. 0 for 5 in catching the football. Would that be about right? Yeah. Now, among these institutions that went 0 for 5 were some very famous ones, I think, Big Ten institutions like the University of Iowa, where I was told by a literacy faculty member there last spring they were proud to have gone 0 for 5. I told them that maybe they shouldn't be proud of that. University of Minnesota went 0 for 5. University of North Carolina, fairly prominent place, 0 for 5. I've got 3 minutes. I'm right on target. Now, I also looked to see if there were any Pennsylvania IHEs included in the Kate Walsh study. There were three. Note that I'm emphasizing there were only three included in the study. So this has nothing to do with Lehigh, Penn State, etc. Three in the University of Pennsylvania. I don't even know where that's at. Went 5 for 5. Temple went 2 for 5. Shippensburg State went 0 for 5. Now, what I'd like to communicate is that there are many institutions that you've never heard of that went 5 for 5. The best institution in Iowa was Buena Vista College up in Storm Lake. They went 4 for 5. University of Northern Iowa, which trains more teachers than all the other institutions put together in the state, went 1 for 5. Okay? We did a study in Illinois. There were a total of 31 institutions of higher education that trained special education teachers for high incidence disabilities. Primarily, these are institutions training teachers to teach children and youth with learning disabilities. And we simply rated them as inadequate or doing most of the areas. So we had about half the institutions, not quite half the institutions, that did pretty well in vocabulary. Fewer than a third on phonemic awareness, about 40% on phonics. These are preparing special education teachers. Only one institution did universal screening. Universal screening methods that are widely used with response to intervention. And not a single institution in 2007, when we collected these data, taught prospective special ed teachers getting master's degrees progress monitoring. Now, we thought it can't be this bad, so we wrote back to all the institutions and said, send us anything else you have that would reflect what you do in reading. Send us, if there's an undergraduate course that's a prerequisite, send us those materials, etc. It didn't get better. It did not get better. Now, we looked at the course syllabi. I love some of these course syllabi. Major course project. Explain your philosophy of literacy. You know how I'd have done on that. I'd have probably said, I'm for it. But I'd have flunked, of course. 1 minute? All right. Develop a bulletin board to motivate children to read. I see. Produce a journal explaining your personal experience in learning to read. Gee, I'll bet that would be really insightful. Analyze the social justice implications of literacy. Well, I can tell you what the social justice implications are. If you don't learn to read, your chances of experiencing social justice as an individual or as a group are significantly diminished. I'm going to have to skip a couple of things. Oh, here's one of them. I love this one. Incidentally, I was going over the math panel slides in the prior slide, and the math panel said the same things, including teaching to automaticity, basic arithmetic facts. All right, some things don't make sense. What really works with kids and what's emphasized in current teacher preparation in general education, particularly for elementary teachers, is way, way out of whack. So we have this woman, who's quite obviously pregnant. She's worried about the noise from the small construction project over there. You can see at the far left side of the slide. Worried about that noise bothering her or interfering with the development of her young and born child while she's smoking a Camel. All right, are there hopeful signs? Not any right now. Oh, there we go. Quickly, going to go through the hopeful signs. Things are getting better in teacher prep. First, the knowledge base exists to improve teacher preparation. It's more accessible, more available now than at any time in the last 100 years. We have the value-added analyses of graduates' effects that are brought back to bear on an evaluation of the institution of higher education. The state that's the farthest along with this right now is Louisiana, but other states are catching up rapidly, including Florida. George will perhaps talk about Florida. There are a number of external pressures on institutions of higher education from the Higher Education Act, from the evaluations of teacher education graduates versus Teach for America graduates, from the alternative certification programs. There's the NCCTQ innovation configurations that we've developed, and if anybody's interested, I'd be glad to send you those things, where we try to specify the critical components of content and skills across key areas in teacher preparation, and they've been used widely in the 325T OSEP grant programs. And then finally, there's that great elephant in the room that's not yet brayed or spoken, but will, and that's the NCTQ U.S. News and World Report study of all colleges of education in the United States. It probably won't come as a surprise to you that the AACTE, College Dean's Organization, is implacably opposed to this effort, but it'll come out in about late 2012 or 2013, and what I can say about it is it'll be more wrong than right. So I think teacher preparation is essential to RTI. We have a long ways to go to apply these, to make sure the science of instruction is communicated adequately to teachers in preparation. And that science of instruction is fundamental to us obtaining better results. Thank you.
Teachers make a difference. And I think that data you presented related to three good teachers overcoming the effects of what we know to be very difficult effects, that is poverty, is an incredible outcome. And you pointed very much to the instruction of reading using more explicit instruction, more direct instruction, as working very well. But one of the things I always hear from teachers when we ask them to go in that direction has to do with the feeling that that approach can often remove creativity in the teaching process and put teachers in a position of not doing what they really love to do and what they're so well trained to do.
You know, an interesting thing about the creativity claim is that the most effective way to teach creativity is for teachers to model creativity, to go through their thought processes. And in fact, there's a strong literature showing that direct instruction in creativity produces more creative output from students than the traditional sort of enrichment, think about this, etc. There's a good literature on teacher modeling as a way to stimulate students' creativity. And I would just simply cite that literature.
Do you think there's a possibility of changing higher education? What will change higher education's effort to train teachers differently in terms of reading process?
I think the two things that will change higher education most dramatically will be feedback on the success of their graduates in producing achievement that goes directly back to the IHE, that institution of higher education. It's already had a dramatic effect in Louisiana. If you're a College of Education dean, and there are, at the time, there were only 15 of the 25 IHEs that had enough teacher education graduates to be included in the value-added study. And your school's teacher education graduates ranked 15th out of 15? I believe that's a dean who then becomes highly motivated, because it's also published in the newspaper,
It goes to the legislature, and there are very serious questions asked right away. I think that alone, and that's starting to happen in almost every state, that alone will have a big impact. I think the second thing that will have a big impact is the U.S. News World Report NCTQ study. It'll be coming out later this year or early next. It'll make a big splash. It'll be a huge media coverage of that. And what it will say is that many teacher preparation programs do not teach the science of instruction. That'll be a main take home. And so I think that'll have a benefit.
All right. Thank you, Dan.
Thank you.
Now we'll hear from Dr. George Batsche.
Thank you, Ed. Good evening. Good evening. Thank you. I also want to thank you very much for a guy from Florida, whatever you did to delay the snow. It was greatly appreciated. Kind of segueing something that Dan just talked about, I want to give you the context tonight for the culture of education in Florida. I would like to talk about how we were, in essence, mandated to implement RTI in all the schools in the state of Florida within a specified span of time. I would like to show you some of the effects that that implementation has been correlated with in terms of student performance, special education placement rates, and then finally show you some of the relationships we have between implementing RTI, implementing it well, and what happens to student outcomes. I don't have a slide up here yet. I don't have a slide up here to give you the context about Florida, but as Dan was speaking and Ed was speaking, I want to take about 2 minutes to do that. Florida is different than Pennsylvania. I've had the opportunity to work in Pennsylvania. Actually, I'm coming back here in a month to do some work with some of the school districts, but Florida is different. And the context of Florida right now is very simple. We no longer have teacher tenure. It was eliminated 12 months ago. If you were tenured and you do not switch school districts, you will maintain your tenure, but you will still participate in the same teacher evaluation system as everyone else. If you switch school districts, you lose tenure, and you do not have the option to get it back. I'm not necessarily advocating this, so don't shoot the messenger. I'm just telling you what the culture is. With the exception of one school district, the one I happen to live in, Tampa, Hillsborough County, all teacher evaluations are divided in 50% skill demonstration and 50% student growth data. Not actual performance, but growth. The skills that you're assessed according to are known as the Florida Educator Accomplished Practices. And here's how I want to segue with Dr. Reschly. Those Florida Educator Accomplished Practices are the outcomes that must be demonstrated by all graduates from teacher education programs in the state of Florida. They are the same skills that you will be evaluated against as a practicing teacher once you're employed in the school. So the bridge, Dan, is that the exiting behaviors in higher education become the entrance evaluation skills in practice. RTI is very simple. There are four or five elements to it. But the simplest way for me to explain it and for me to understand it is, here is where a student or a group of students are. Here's where you want them to be. Here's how much time you have to get them there. How fast do they have to grow to get there? If they're behind in September and you know that, you have 9 months to do something about it. If you benchmark along the way, mileposts, you will know whether what you're doing is keeping the student up. So for a teacher, if I were back in the classroom, and having been a building principal for about 10 years and doing teacher evaluations, if I were a teacher in September or October, and half of my teacher evaluation was based upon that student growth. I would want to know in September or October what I needed to do to hit the benchmark for the students, which, by the way, is for myself, in April or May. So I want it to be understood clearly that the stuff I'm going to say about the implementation of RTI in Florida is accelerated by the fact that this system of decision-making gives teachers tools now that they can use not only to accelerate student performance, but also for their self-preservation as a professional. So all of a sudden, teachers who were not interested in this 5 years ago, it is now their closest best friend. And how do I find out in September what I need to know to be sure that my students, does this make sense? So I want to be transparent about that. There are some differences because we have been able to implement this process fairly quickly. And I want to try to now tell you that story a little bit. And I have more slides up here than we could possibly get through in the time that Dr. Shapiro has allowed us. And his background in behavioral psychology, he has been very positive that if we get done on time, there might be some beverages. And if we don't, we're going to be punished severely. And being a good behavioral person, he has left us to wonder what that might be. Novelty, curiosity certainly accelerates one's attention to learning. This is a definition of RTI that happens to be a national definition because it was in a national policy document. It's basically the same definition that Dr. Shapiro gave before. We have also morphed to multi-tier system of supports for a couple of reasons, two in particular. One, how many of you in here are parents but not educators? Thank you, and thank you for coming. If somebody says RTI, good luck with that, right? But if somebody says multi-tier system of supports, we have multiple tiers of supports for your kid, that makes more sense. So it helped us to communicate. But the other thing is, and something that Dr. Reschly showed in that meta-analysis, the effect size, the bang for your buck, that two of the highest bang for your buck practices were applied behavior analysis. And I think it was CBM with problem solving. RTI is very much about problem solving. Four very simple steps. What do we want kids to know and be able to do? Why aren't they doing it? What are we going to do about it? And did it work? Anybody can understand those steps. We have combined that whole RTI movement with the statewide Florida Positive Behavior Support Initiative. It is now one integrated process. We don't have separate teams. We problem solve student engagement and instructional decision making simultaneously. So because we brought these two together, we had to create a new house. The new house is called multi-tier system of supports. But I want you to pay attention for a moment to that bottom point. In addition to the stuff that Dr. Shapiro and that Dr. Reschly mentioned, there's a third component about multi-tier system of supports. It assumes that the resources schools are going to get, types of teachers, funding, supports, will be directly related to student need based upon student performance data, and not a formula based upon demographics or number of students in the school. This is need-driven resources. That is why this model is also known as a return on investment model. You invest in it at a certain level with a decision and you look for outcomes. So just because you would have a school with 97% free and reduced lunch and 98% English language learners, which is East Little Havana Elementary School in Miami-Dade, that school makes AYP. It looks like it would be in tremendous need of tremendous supports. We now provide supports to schools based upon two pieces of data. One, their level of implementation of MTSS, and two, student outcome data. So that third thing is really important for this scaling up. And basically the scaling up, and I'm going to go through a bunch of slides here quickly, We had the opportunity to do along about the same time that Dr. Zimmet and Dr. Shapiro had their grant to implement RTI in Florida. And our funding source said to us, we'll be glad to fund you to do this research, but oh, by the way, in order to get this money, you have to do the whole state of Florida. That's how we're gonna do it. So being money-hungry people, we decided that we would take the money and do both of those things. So we had to come up with a model to be able to slowly do this. We began in 2004, and we are now in our eighth year of this implementation. So this issue is, how do we get every school, the Chancellor of Education in Florida, your superintendent maybe, said to me, George, I want you to tell me the day I can walk into any fourth grade in one of the 3,100 schools in Florida and see RTI happening in any one of those classrooms, and I'll pick them at random. That was our charge. That was our litmus test. Consistency of implementation. So where your kid goes to school shouldn't matter. They would have the same quality of instruction. So we had evidence-based models of systems change. How do you move large systems? Evidence-based models of RTI. We needed state leadership support. We had to have a strong professional development network, technical assistance. We had to teach districts to build their own capacity. We couldn't do it from the outside. We could start it, but we couldn't sustain it. And we had to have an evaluation model. We called it using RTI to do RTI. If we're expecting you to do database decision-making, we had to do it in scaling this effort up. So in 2003 and 2007, we did a lot of awareness, a lot of consensus building, just conversations. In 2007 through 2010, we did two things. We had demonstration districts to tell us how well these scaling up things were working, and we were teaching statewide teams from districts and schools to do this so that districts had trained people that had the capacity to ultimately help the district do it themselves. And a year and a half ago, we began working only with districts to help them organize themselves to use the capacity they had to take responsibility for doing this in their own district. So that was basically the plan. We have about, you don't need to see this, we have about 31 people that work on this one project. Between the two, we have about 65 people, give or take. The sustainable scaling up, the model we used is this: building consensus, getting people comfortable with it, understanding the need for it, having the skills to do it. Second, giving them the tools to do it, and only then implementation. Going slow to go fast. If you don't, our data shows us, everybody loves RTI for 18 months until they have to change their behavior. And then they say things, well, I didn't know if I was doing RTI, I had to do that. Particularly teachers who, kids don't go to that class because they need more reading. I didn't know kids weren't gonna get to come to my class, you didn't tell me that. So that consensus, helping people be comfortable, establish a culture of doing this, is woven throughout the process. It's really, really important. Going slow to go fast. And that's just explaining that. But here's what we learned. Until and unless consensus is established, moving forward is a nightmare. It is a nightmare. Take the time to build professional communities around this process of change. Don't follow the philosophy, no teacher, or do follow the philosophy, no teacher left behind. Here are reasons why it's failed. The number one is consensus. A couple of other things on here, unrealistic expectations. You're a sixth grade teacher, you have a student come into sixth grade, student is working at the seventh grade level, you expect RTI to have the kid at the seventh grade level at the end of sixth grade. That's not going to work. And not involving everybody in the planning. We all have the tiers. I want to emphasize something I think that Dr. Shapiro said. Tier one, the reality show of education is tier one. Tier two and tier three are great. Supplemental intensive instruction. Nationally, 58% of kids getting tier three are not special ed kids. In Florida, it's 64% of kids getting tier three services are not special ed kids. Special ed kids are all through there. If you cannot be successful in Tier 1, you're not going to be successful in real life. National Longitudinal Study comes out every year looking at the percent of kids who are successful post-secondary in different exceptionality areas. Quoted by Fuchs and Fuchs, last year 57% of all kids in K-12 SLD programs were unemployed 1 year post-secondary. It's not a good indicator of how well things are going. So Tier 1 is the reality show. I'm going to skip that. I'm going to skip the district needs assessment. I've pretty much told you all of this. There's a huge conceptual match between positive behavior support and RTI. In other words, they work well together. There's not a lot of differences in philosophy. Our mission in Florida is basically this integrated service system with the district being able to implement it themselves. In Florida, we passed regulations first, general education regulations, not requiring RTI, but requiring the practices of RTI for all teachers in Tier 1. All of those practices are listed. We have three areas of special education that eligibility is RTI only. The three high incidence areas, learning disabilities, behavior disorders, and language impairment. And we have funding tied to the implementation of it. I'm going to skip over what we actually did with professional development. Our evaluation model looked at input factors, what happened in schools, and what the outcomes were. We have lots of data sources and lots of data. If you go to the website, floridarti.usf.edu, check your auditory memory, floridarti, one word, .usf, University of South Florida, .edu, you can get this technical manual on how we did it and how we measured it. And it's free. It'll cost you basically a color cartridge downloading it. $32. So what have we accomplished in the past 7 years? These graphs reflect over a 4-year period of time the rate of implementation of the practices of RTI in the schools in Florida. These are aggregated, collapsed data. What does this tell us? It tells us it takes 2 to 4 years to get schools consistently doing these kinds of practices. 2 to 4 years. It also tells us that getting the practices implemented and getting them done the right way are two separate processes. The blue lines basically show fidelity or implementing it the way it's supposed to be implemented. Prior to professional development and technical assistance, every school we went to said, we've been doing RTI for years. And then when we observed it, direct observation, permanent product review, we're like, not so much. After this intense professional development and coaching, technical assistance, the fidelity levels of 1 were acceptable. You see the tremendous difference between doing it the right way on your own and doing it the right way with direct instruction and support. It's critical. Now, what are some of these are just some more fidelity data showing the same thing. This, and by the way, I'm going to skip back to that. This is the rate of implementation of positive behavior support in schools in Florida. It took a number of years to get capacity built, and once the capacity was built, the acceleration was tremendous. Now we have it in about 60% of the schools in Florida. So the findings. Consensus is important, and when it's developed, implementation follows. You have to have the district committed to doing this, not allowing schools to do it by themselves. Schools apply this more readily in the area of reading language arts than they do other areas initially. And you need training, coaching, and you have to scaffold the process, give them the support, and slowly pull the supports away. What are barriers? Lack of leadership. 5 priorities for implementing RTI, leadership, 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 planning and scheduling. Staff turnover is a huge problem because of the skill set moving in and out. Infrastructure, in the problem solving process, everyone has difficulty with problem analysis, figuring out why aren't they able to do that. They just jump to programs without figuring out whether that program is what the student needs. They become too dependent on the coach if you let them do that. Failure to build capacity. Inconsistent messages, having a different definition in different schools. Jumping to implementation before consensus and infrastructure is established. So what are some of the outcomes we've achieved? This graph summarizes special education placement rates in the state of Florida over a 6-year period of time. With the exception of autism spectrum disorders on the top, every area of special education has declined in its placement rates, including SLD, which has declined almost 50%. But also, students identified with mental handicap, emotional behavior disorders, have also declined. It's not that the students don't have disabilities. It is that their educational needs are being met without labeling. These show the improvement in students with disabilities as a result of fewer students receiving the services. Dramatic increases in proficiency levels and dramatic decreases in basic performance levels. These are examples of significant increases in elementary schools in math with schools that were in 2 years of training, cohort number one, 1 year of training, cohort number two, and not yet in training. You see the percent of those schools that increase to proficient and advanced levels. The longer you're in this, the greater the impact on students. These are high schools aggregated, cohort one, cohort two, in the language arts area. The same effect, not quite as dramatic. This is the application of this in Wichita Public Schools and the impact on white and non-white students and accelerating rates of growth after 1 year of district-wide implementation. And the last thing that I want to go over with you is this. This is a summary table, it's descriptive statistics, that asks this question. What is the relationship between how well RTI is implemented, staff perceptions of what's going on in the school, and student outcomes? So basically, there are two kinds. High implementing schools, schools that were implementing it well, and low implementing schools, schools that were not implementing it well. Although they were all implementing. The first thing I want to point out is student growth. These were 450 schools, K through 12, in Los Angeles, California. They use an API index to indicate student growth. You don't need to know what that is. You will see the API index for low implementing schools was plus 11. That's significant. But plus 16 for high implementing, 50% greater growth in high implementing schools. And now just look at two things, and then I'll be done. When the staff was asked, what's happening in this school, in these schools, they were aggregated data. Look at the bottom. Data were collected to ensure that the instruction and intervention plan was implemented as intended. In the high implementing schools, 60% of the teachers agreed with that. In the low implementing schools, 14% agreed with that. And teacher received staff support to implement the plan. 40% said yes in high implementing schools, and this was after 2 years, and 14% in the low implementing schools. We believe that there is sufficient evidence, not only on the impact for teachers and other staff, but students to continue this movement of implementing RTI as a way of educating, but ensuring that it's done consistently and with fidelity. Thank you.
I think what I'm going to do is we're going to move to Dr. Calhoun's presentation, and we have a little time for conversation. I think an interesting question I'd like to ask you, George. I'm going to introduce Dr. Beth Calhoun from Lehigh University.
How many of you guys teach older kids, adolescents, sixth grade and up? So we've got a few of us. That's what I taught when I taught was middle school. So those kids have my heart. And the main reason that I went ahead and got into this business was I wanted to help these kids who were so far behind. So I decided that I was going to create a reading program, because by the time they were this old, And then people were trying to teach them to read. Everything was babyfied. So it was a twofold problem with these kids. They didn't want to have to be working with this babyfied stuff. Plus, we didn't really have any programs out there that were developed specifically for that. What we found out with older students is this happens when they don't learn how to read. They have lower self-esteem. They're going to leave high school illiterate. They end up perceiving their reading problems as immutable, meaning nothing can be done for them. They struggle to read and comprehend even simple as coursework, and they have deficits in the areas of word identification and phonological processing, along with comprehension, along with everything else that goes with reading. We're still on one. I will do that continually. So we know that without intensive and explicit remedial reading curricula for this group of kids, they're going to drop out and they're going to join the increasing mass of adult illiterates. I have friends who work with adult literacy. We have an incredibly high illiterate rate for adults in this country. And we are adding to it yearly with our dropout rates from our high school kids. Now, we have had decades of research on how to teach beginning reading. There has been tons of money put into it. How to teach it, I mean the K through 3 level, how to teach it. Which of the reading components to emphasize? Reading components, I mean the big 5 that Dr. Reschly was talking about. When to emphasize them. When to do what, with whom, with them. When do we teach them? How do we teach them? How do we put them together in a program? There has been so much research done on this. Everybody knows about it. When now we have quality programs for these young kids that combine or integrate this explicit, systematic, direct instruction in all the reading components within every single lesson. How many of you guys have seen the core reading programs that have been developed? Those beginning reading programs for the kids, right? Research is telling us that for them, we need to teach within every lesson the phonics, the spelling, the fluency, the vocabulary, the comprehension, the writing. All of that has to be integrated into one, because that's what research has shown us works best for these younger kids. Now, what's interesting, though, is very little research has been done on how do we best work and teach these older kids who don't know how to read to read. We have assumed that we should just give them what we give the beginner readers, because it works for the beginner readers. So we'll just put a new package on it and present things to them. But what we're finding is that we are not remediating these kids. A lot of them are continuing to go through 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th grade, and they're still reading at the secondary level or the third grade level. So Resnick, I found this interesting quote that I like, said that there's two main biases in reading instruction. One is that we have to put a heavy emphasis on decoding, and another camp that says there should be a heavy emphasis on comprehension. These biases that people develop in teaching reading have led to a piecemeal approach to instruction. And we're seeing it more than ever in our adolescent literacy, remedial reading. There was a meta-analysis done by Edmonds in 2009, which he looked at the current research that's out there on adolescent literacy. What she found was that there were only 29 empirical studies from 1994 to 2004. 13 of those studies only taught comprehension to the kids. 5 focused only on fluency. 4 focused only on word study instruction. 3 at least taught 2 of the components. 2 taught comprehension and fluency. And 1 actually taught fluency, comprehension, and another one actually did finally 3 of the components. So what we're seeing is people going in to the older kids and just giving them one component. They're not giving them this whole complete package that's developed just for them like we did for the younger kids. So we need to understand for these older kids which reading components to improvise to provide the most effective and efficient means for these adolescents with RD to acquire reading skills. We need to have reading intervention studies that, when people go and compare reading intervention studies, usually they're comparing two different programs. Like someone might say, I'm going to look at Wilson compared to Read 1-8. But when you do that, those programs are so different, it's very difficult to figure out what parts of those programs are actually causing things to work well or not well. It's kind of like, let's do apples to oranges instead of oranges to oranges. So you also have theoretical issues. You have all these direct comparison problems. So I set out to try to kind of solve this, to try to figure out how can we create a good reading program and what would a good reading program look like for adolescents. And it's just been a heck of a lot of fun. I know y'all are like, woohoo, on the edge of your seats. Okay, so what I did was I created a reading program that has these four components: linguistics, which is your phonics, spelling, which is your working with words, speed reading, which is your fluency, and it's all kind of based around peer-assisted learning strategies, which was developed by Lynn and Doug Fuchs out of Vanderbilt. It's all based on a peer-mediated thing. So, it's a program that has these four reading components. It has, the interesting thing is that each of these components is a standalone component. Therefore, I can mix and match them. So I can make numerous different modules. I can create numerous programs out of one program to try to look and see what works best for what kids. For example, here is one of the schedules I created, one of the programs I created, that all these kids are going to get is comprehension and linguistics. Okay? Color-coded for fun. So the comprehension is in the turquoise and the linguistics is in the green. So on this schedule, kids will get comprehension on Monday, linguistics Tuesday, Wednesday, Friday, and then comprehension on Thursday. I created another schedule that's an integrated schedule where they get comprehension Monday, Thursday, then they get a combination of linguistics, fluency, and spelling on Tuesday, Wednesday, Friday. Then I created another one that I call the additive module, where I begin by just teaching phonics or linguistics. And then after they've gone through 7 weeks of that, then I add spelling in. 7 weeks of that, then I add fluency in. Then they're done with their linguistics, and then I add comprehension to their spelling and fluency. So what I'm looking at is how do we best put together a reading program for these older kids? And which of these programs is going to work best for these older kids that are our low readers and get us our biggest bang for our buck to raise their reading level. Anybody have any guesses as to what might happen here? No? Okay, so I did a study. This is the second study out of three that I've done so far. I have 6th through 8th graders. They all had reading disability. They were all those really low readers that were reading at 3.5 grade level or below. Most of them were reading in the second and below. We did 26 weeks of instruction for a total of 97 hours. We randomly assigned them across the three different programs. So here was the assessment we did. We did the Woodcock-Johnson. We had all of these assessments. What we found was that every single one of these modules or programs, all of the kids got significant differences. They all grew significantly in all three programs. But that's not really what I wanted to look at. I wanted to see which of these programs did they grow the best in. So if we compare each of the different modules, this is the integrated versus the alternating, we find some very interesting things that's happening with these students in their response to this intervention. If you look at the alternating and the integrated, first off, the alternating didn't get any fluency or spelling. However, these two modules reacted similarly to each other. There was very little difference between how the students responded. They both grew the same amount with this, both of these schedules. Adding the fluency in this organization of the components didn't add anything more than not giving it to the kids at all. The same with the spelling. So if we start to look at how do we put the components together the best for these adolescents, it's interesting that when we do it all together with the Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday with the linguistic spelling and phonics, we're not getting any bigger bang for our buck than just giving them linguistics and comprehension and not providing spelling and fluency. When we look at the additive versus the alternating, this additive model, where we give them isolated phonics up front and slowly add each of these components, it outperformed the alternating module on everything except the reading fluency, where they performed similarly. Which is interesting when you start thinking about the order of how you're putting these components together. When you look at the additive versus the integrated, where everybody gets the same components, you're just looking at a different organization. And the additive, once again, significantly outperformed the integrated. One thing that's interesting is there is a lot of these adolescent programs out there that they're not finding results for. They're finding very little significance, very little growth for these kids. I'm averaging 2.5 years growth in word recognition, 2.5 years growth in nonsense words, and 2.5 years growth in comprehension for these 6th through 8th graders. Now that's the average. I've got a lot of kids that are growing up into 4 years, 4.5 years on these measures, which is happening mainly in this additive group, where I'm giving them this upfront loading of phonics. Now, what we're seeing here with these adolescents is that differing amounts of time devoted to different components is producing different outcomes for this age group. We're also finding that differing organizations of the components is producing differing outcomes. And that the amount of time and organization are very sensitive to and play a major role in the production of reading outcomes for this population. Now, no one else is really looking at how do we put together programs, remedial reading programs, designed specifically for these older kids who have either A, gone through some sort of reading program and failed miserably, or B, have gone through a holistic constructivist program and never really received quality reading instruction. But yet they're different, and we know they're different, than that homogeneous group that comes in at kindergarten and doesn't even know any sounds and any letters. So your older kids who have been through some reading are a very different group than these younger kids. We also know that approximately the same amount of time devoted to different components within different organizations can produce different outcomes for older students. For example, in the additive program, they got 15 hours of spelling. The integrated got 13 hours of spelling. There's only 2 hours difference within the amount of instructional time. Yet, the additive component and program was the only one that got significance in spelling. So it had to do with the organization of when they got the components as opposed to just the fact that they got them. So instead of getting that spelling all along with the integrated, there was something different about getting the phonics up front, then adding the spelling, then adding everything in. So all of this is playing a huge difference in the best way to remediate these kids. So implications. Our adolescent remedial reading programs. We have to do more research before we know the best order and amount of time for each component to maximize response to treatment. For older students with RD, the organization of isolated linguistics provided up front, with the addition of each of these components separately, appears to produce the best results for phonics, spelling, fluency, and comprehension results for these older kids. Now, we know that decoding is necessary but not sufficient for reading. It's interesting that researchers in the field of adolescent literacy mistakenly promote the idea that placing too much emphasis on or teaching these decoding skills in isolation leads students to becoming unmotivated word callers, lacking in reading comprehension skills. A lot of researchers and a lot of teachers at this age are afraid to provide heavy decoding to adolescents because of this fear that we're missing out on comprehension. They're not learning comprehension. We're not going to teach them how to become comprehenders of reading. This study and the other studies that I've done are showing just the exact opposite, that the more decoding and phonics instruction that we give them so that they can unlock the text, the better they're getting at comprehension. And so it's the additive where they're getting that upfront, solid, deep foundation of phonics that really is appearing to generalize more into this higher gains in comprehension. And then when we want to see gains in fluency, it's the integrated and the additive that are doing really good with that. So where do we go from here? We want to compare more in depth the organizational structure of the additive and integrative models. We also want to have students, we want to look at, the other things that I want to look at is doing this in more of an RTI model. I'm currently working at Easton where we've got it in their intervention time, where it's their intervention period. And then, I want to eventually try to individualize students to models to figure out which students work best with which models so that you can start really customizing a reading program for these older students and helping them identify the needs they really have so that we can really bolster and get our biggest bang for our buck with them. So, thank you for your interest in adolescent literacy, and I will turn it back over.
Thank you, Beth. See, I just have one quick question that occurred to me, and I think it's a relevant one that many, many teachers would ask. And you sort of alluded to it at the very end, that very typically with adolescents who are struggling with reading, the emphasis is on teaching comprehension, because of a concern about being successful on the state test, in our state PSSA. Can you respond a little bit to that? What happens to these kids in your study who get this heavy linguistic approach, phonics approach, in terms of their outcomes on state tests?
In the states that we've used this in, we've had about a 98% passage rate on the state comprehension test. And for the first time, the kids had to have a modification of having a reader. They actually read the test themselves. So it's what we're finding out is that allowing them to finally be able to decode the words is unlocking a comprehension that's already there. It's just they haven't been able to understand how to read the word to unlock that comprehension. The vocabulary, and I can't actually say the vocabulary is there, but the comprehension of what they're reading is there. They just haven't been able to read it before. And so we're getting really, really good results on the statewide tests.
Great, great. I'll introduce Dr. Naomi Zigman, who will be our fourth speaker tonight.
Z, you'd think I'd get used to being the last speaker. But I was sitting there looking at my watch and looking at my watch. We've heard two talks about RTI, which have involved a reorganization of how teachers think about teaching all kids. And then we've heard a talk about teaching a very specific group of kids who have very severe and persistent reading problems. About the first, I want to say that I've been in this business a very long time, longer than any of them, by the way. And at one point, I was doing some in-service work on mainstreaming, which was what we used to say before we talked about inclusion. And after I'd given this talk, I was in the teacher's lounge getting a cup of coffee, and I overheard, people didn't know I was there, I overheard this one teacher in a very disgusted voice saying, "Mainstreaming, mainstreaming, mainstreaming. You know, mainstreaming is no pancreas." Well, RTI is no pancreas either. And what I want to talk to you about is the approximately 5% of kids who don't succeed in tier one, don't succeed in tier two, and don't succeed in tier three. And we still don't know what to do with them. They end up in special education, although fewer of them may end up in special education than before, they end up in special education. And the question for me is, what do we do in special education for kids with learning disabilities meeting their unique needs in the current standards-based, research-based RTI environment? There's a lot to learn in school. There's content, there's skills, and actually we learn skills in a hierarchical way. There is no teaching of beginning reading in general. Once you hit fourth or fifth grade, you're supposed to know that already. There's no teaching of, you know, spelling as an explicit instruction after a certain point in time. You're supposed to know that. So there's a time frame for learning these things. But there's also other things that kids learn at school. Most kids learn those things. These are things I use the very technical term special stuff to talk about. These are usually things that kids learn just from being in school. They learn what to put into their backpacks every day. They learn how to come into class and get your bum on the seat without falling over on the floor and making a fool of yourself. They learn to control their behavior. They learn that if everybody is in the cafeteria blowing Jell-O through straws, when the principal enters the cafeteria room, you stop. They learn social skills and how the distance between people is important. They learn self-advocacy. They learn all kinds of things in school. That third column, you'll notice, is not standards based. There are no core standards for that third stuff. And most kids don't need instruction in that third stuff. But in my experience, the kids with learning disabilities that end up in special education, that 5% or so of kids who don't make it, need explicit instruction in every one of those things. They have intelligence, they have motivation, although after a while, one might wonder what their motivations are. I remember studying a high school in which I was trying to understand dropouts, and I began the research looking at why do kids stay in school, and after spending days and days and days in this particular high school, I changed my question and asked, why do kids why don't kids leave? So motivation can certainly be an issue. But the point is that kids with learning disabilities need explicit instruction in all those things. Today's climate is a full inclusion climate, especially here in Pennsylvania. We've been very much motivated to include kids as much as possible in general education classrooms. Since the Gaskin case, as many of you know, there's been this tremendous push for more and more inclusion. We have RTI in Pennsylvania, we have two I's, and standards-based IEPs. We have the requirement for evidence-based instruction and the requirement for all kids, including kids with learning disabilities, including those high school kids reading at the third and fourth grade level, to take the general accountability assessments every spring. This is the climate in which we are living and in which the kids that I'm talking about are struggling in school. The underlying message that teachers and parents and professionals are getting is that the most important things that are going on in general education classrooms. It's as if there's a secret there. And general education teachers are telling the kids who are sitting in front of them some secret. And if our kids aren't sitting there, see that empty chair? If our kids aren't sitting there, they're not getting to hear that secret. The most important things are going on in a general education classroom, and that the job of special education and the special education teacher are to help students who may be labeled or may not be labeled to get the most they can out of sitting in that general education classroom. The highest priority is for everybody to learn the same curriculum in the same place from the same teachers and take the same test at the end. Now, I may be exaggerating this much, but not much more than that. And that we have for everyone the same post-high school goals and the same outcomes expected. After all, by 2014, everybody, 100% of kids, are supposed to be able to read at or above grade level. So we need to think about what's the role of a special education teacher in this kind of an environment. One role that we have given the special ed teacher is that of support. The students are going to be in that general education classroom. They're going to learn the words of wisdom, the pearls that are coming from the general education teacher. I don't mean to be sarcastic, but I need to keep you awake. And they're going to learn the general education curriculum, and the special education teacher is going to be in that classroom to provide support through co-teaching. Co-teaching has become the most popular service delivery model of special education across the country. Now, research findings tell us that co-teaching is really nice. Teachers like it. They hate it at the very beginning, but then they like it. After all, if you have two teachers in the classroom, one of you can go to the bathroom. If you have two teachers in the classroom, you can share some of the grading. Although I've known regular education teachers who are reluctant to let their special education teacher partner grade, especially English papers, because maybe, you know, they're not quite the same in terms of their requirements and their expectations. So, co-teaching is nice. Co-teaching is an occasional relief for the general ed or the special ed teacher. And research has shown us, observational research has shown us, that with co-teaching, all the kids in the classroom get a teeny bit more of individual attention. Individual attention, by which I mean that there's a teacher there who can wake you up. There's a teacher there who can redirect you and make sure you're on task. There's a teacher there who can help you find the right place. There's a teacher there who can help you get through the assignment. But there is, and some of this work is mine, but some of this work isn't mine, there is nothing in the research literature that could convince us that what the co-teacher does in a general education classroom will lead to mastery of the general education curriculum. What you need for students who are hard to teach to learn what they need to learn is elaborative explanations, a different way of saying it, a clearer way of saying it, a more complete explanation, strategic instruction, a way of using mnemonics or strategies to help you remember and retrieve information, intensive instruction, not a learning it because you're hearing it, but learning it because you're being taught it, and reteaching of concepts. There is no evidence that these things go on in most, you know, you may have the exception, but in most co-taught classrooms. So in co-teaching, if this is, I love the fact that our very first speaker talked about time and where you want to go, and he had this graph. Well, I'm going to lend him this one. Most students go from here to here over the course of their school career. This could be a year or this could be 12 years. Kids with disabilities, kids with learning disabilities, start lower. They often come to school with fewer basic skills because those need to be explicitly taught, and some preschools and parents don't have the skills to teach explicitly the skills that you need to even begin school. And with co-teaching, they will learn some, but you can see that on this trajectory, they're falling farther and farther and farther behind. Okay? So, that's not good enough for me. I've devoted my career not to general education teachers and general education kids, not kids in tier one, not kids in tier two, maybe not even kids in tier three, but those 5% of kids who are really, really, really hard to teach. I'm sorry to be so technical, but really, really, really hard to teach. And for those kids, just learning some is just not good enough. We owe them more than that. So an alternative to this, would be the more traditional pull-out programs. I'm not talking about self-contained classes necessarily. I'm talking about traditional resource room programs, which are disappearing as we get more and more excited about inclusion and co-teaching. These are maybe kids in groups of 8 to 15 kids at a time, and a special education teacher. No aid, because we couldn't possibly afford that. So, you know, quite a few kids, not 25 necessarily, but quite a few kids, and a teacher, providing supplemental instruction. Some call this tier three. I'm calling it tier four, but some call this tier three. And it could be for short term or it could be for long term. We've often heard about special education kids going into, labeled into special education as lifers. And they never get out after that. Maybe 30 to 45 minutes, maybe up to 5 times a week in Mary Beth's discussion, she said that she had 26 weeks of instruction for 97 hours. That's about 3 hours a week. So that makes about the right amount of sense. But in the resource rooms that I've seen lately, the special education teacher feels compelled, because what's going on in the general education class is so important, feels compelled to do homework help, completion of assignments that were not completed in the general education classroom. Can you imagine the general education teacher sending spelling work to the art teacher and saying, could you please spend the art period having them finish the spelling assignment that they had that they didn't finish in my class? You wouldn't hear that, but ask a resource teacher what happens, and very often the kids come with work to finish as if the special education teacher didn't have her own agenda and or his own curriculum that he was planning to teach those kids. Sometimes there's some strategy instruction, very, very useful. Often there's test prep. I've come to believe that in Pennsylvania, at least, we only have about 7 weeks of school between October 1st and Thanksgiving. Then there's Thanksgiving and the holidays. And beginning in January, there is test prep. And we're preparing for the PSSAs. And after that, in April, the PSSAs are over. Might as well close school. So we're lucky if we get 7 weeks of school. And sometimes there is a wonderful program, like the one that we just heard about, remedial instruction in basic skills, but only if there's time, because there are so many other things a special ed teacher is supposed to be doing. So here's our picture again. This wasn't good enough. With a resource program, we might up it a bit. Here we have a parallel line. The kids are learning about at the same rate as their general education peers, but they started lower and they end lower. And that's better, but for me, again, that's not good enough. So what would it take to do that? That's what we want. What would it take to do that? Kids have to learn more faster. What would it take? Have any of you seen the film Stand and Deliver? It should be required viewing for all educators, but especially special education teachers and directors of special education, maybe even legislators. Because
step by step, inch by inch. Calculus was not made to be easy, it already is. Remember the good times we had last summer? Do you remember when things were really jumping good? Yeah. Well, the good times are gone with the wind. It's now the good, the bad, and the ugly.
Oh, come on. A contract? You mean you can't trust us by now?
For those of you making the commitment, it would be preparing yourself for the advanced placement test. Make sure you have one. Make sure it's signed before you come to class tomorrow.
We have before school, take your class 2 periods and stay until 5?
You're doomed. Saturdays? You gotta come on Saturdays? And no vacation?
Yep, pass the AP exam and you get college credit.
So this is a wonderful teacher from the barrios of East Los Angeles, challenging his kids to learn AP calculus. These kids are not doing high school math yet. But he believes that in 2 years, he can get them through the AP calculus test. If, with a small class size, they are willing to spend 2 scheduled periods every day on math, 1 hour before school, after school until 5 o'clock, every Saturday, no vacations, that is, half a day of school, all through Christmas vacation, Easter break, etc., and all through the summer. Now, he's a remarkable teacher. I'm not suggesting that we need to do this. I couldn't do it. But he's suggesting that. And furthermore, he's suggesting this.
Try the shortcut. This is easy. Baby stuff for Boy Scouts.
Come on, my mind don't work this way.
Tic-tac-toe. It's a piece of cake upside down. Watch for the green light.
I've been with you guys 2 years. Everybody knows I'm the dumbest. I can't handle calculus. These guys have a better chance of making the AP test without me. Don't laugh.
How can we laugh? You're breaking our hearts.
Don't do this, Kimo.
I mean, how noble. To sacrifice himself for the benefit of the team. Do you have the ganas? Do you have the desire?
Yes, I have the ganas.
Do you want me to do it for you?
Yes.
You're supposed to say no.
Perseverance, never giving up. I used to talk about special education teachers doing intensive, relentless instruction. That's what it took. And what
yes,
happened?
Yes, I'd like that very much. One moment. Yes, I'm aware of the scoring. 3 is passing grade, 5 is a perfect grade. Yes, I'm ready, go ahead. Diaz, Maria, 4. Cifuentes, Maria, 5. Nadar, Jose, 4.
What the original score sheet stated.
Santos, Daniel, 4. Escobar, Guadalupe, 5. Camejo, Claudia, 4. Ana Delgado, 4. Garcia Francisco, 3. Fuentes Rafaela, 4. Javier Perez, 5. Quintana Armando, 4. Angel Guzman, 5.
These were kids who 2 years before were not doing basic high school math. Okay, gives me the goosebumps every time I see that. So, we do not acknowledge to ourselves or to our kids that learning is hard work. That you can't do everything. That you have to set priorities. That you may have to give up something in order to do something else. So what I'm trying to say is that we have to ourselves and help our families set priorities. There's a lot to learn. There's content, there are skills. There are things that need explicit instruction that we can teach. If school were a limited resource, then if school were an unlimited resource, then we wouldn't have to make choices. But except in East Los Angeles in the 1970s, school isn't an unlimited resource. There is a lot to learn, and the school day is only so long, and we need to use it wisely. So, special education people, we need to set priorities. Content with co-teaching or skills with a special education teacher. You can't do the second in a general education classroom. It would be like having, I said this earlier today, having solo violin lessons in the back of your class. It's not designed for two things to be going on at the same time. I remember very clearly in a full inclusion classroom in which a special ed teacher, second grade, had 3 little boys who couldn't count, let alone do the adding and subtracting that their second grade peers were doing. And so she came into the second grade classroom each day, when they were doing regular math, she took her three little boys to the back of the room and she taught a lesson in math while they did their borrowing and carrying and quite sophisticated second grade mathematics. And she had to talk like this because she couldn't. There were 24 other kids and her three were at a little table in the back of the room. And so she had to teach them very quietly. And she couldn't use a lot of stuff. They were learning, the day that I was there, they were learning how to count to four. Okay? Second grade. But she couldn't have them jump four times and clap four times and march four times because they had to be quiet because there was another lesson going on in the other side of the room. So I think we need to make choices. We can help students acquire, I think we must help students acquire the skills that they need to function in the real world. And one of our advantages is that special education is a mandate, and we have to use that resource wisely. We need to exploit the opportunities available to us to teach students with disabilities the things that they absolutely need to learn and can't learn from anybody else. So it's up to you. Support or teach. Thank you.
I have a question. I have a question. So I'm a parent of a student that I was just told, young third grade, second grade, I was just told for the first time, my son or daughter has a learning disability, and it's a severe one. What do I advocate for? Because I know what I'm going to be told by the school that involves inclusion. Do I advocate for that, or do I not advocate?
But they said, were my kid, I would not advocate for inclusion. I would advocate for 4 hours a day of reading instruction. And 4 hours a day may be an exaggeration, but there are studies that show that really, really, really hard to teach kids can learn to read with intensive, relentless instruction. And I don't necessarily mean 4 hours, you know, all at the same time, but maybe a half hour and then a break and then a half hour and a break. We don't have the resources for that.
Right.
But that's what I'd ask.
Ferguson
showed that. And he showed that he could teach these kids to read, but it took 4 hours a day. So that's what I would advocate.
And I shouldn't worry about any loss of socialization that many people would be concerned about.
No, there are a lot of people that are doing cyber school. You know, where's socialization there? There are lots of kids homeschooled. You know, I think that kids are resilient. They'll learn some of these other things on their own. And learning literacy and numeracy are so important that that's what we need to do. But we have to make choices. You know, it may mean you don't play football. It may mean you don't learn social studies that year. It may mean giving up other things. That's why I said it's a matter of priorities. And we have to figure out for each individual kid who is diagnosed with a learning disability and entitled to special education, what is appropriate for that kid.
First of all, I want to thank the panel for very, very interesting presentations tonight. We've got a big range of ideas here. I knew Dr. Zygmunt would provide us with a go-away message that I know she's been telling me for all of my career about when we work together. It's all about those tier three and other kids that we have to be worried about. I'd like to thank the panel and give a round of applause to everyone. I really appreciate everyone. We ran over a little bit because we started late tonight. I have to make sure I remind everyone, if you're having Act 48 credits, you're supposed to complete the evaluation, and I assume leave it somewhere, wherever that is. somewhere out there, there's someone who's going to take that evaluation from you so you get your Act 48 credits. Thanks again very much for coming tonight and giving your time on behalf of kids with learning disabilities. Thank you very much.